Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Let me hear you. Woo. Good morning.
Good morning.
Are you guys ready to praise God? Let's have you stand to your feet. Let's go.
Come on, everyone. Put our hands together. This way. Come on. Yeah. Oh, we praise you, God. Hallelujah to the name of Jesus. Come on. Make some noise. Come on.
Come on. You never stop. 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak of Jesus. I just want to seek the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like a fire.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
From the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Oh,
shout Jesus from
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. Come on and sing that with me now. I just want to speak I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Oh, speak it over every heart and every mind. Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus, your name.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Break every stronghold.
Break every stronghold.
Shine
through the shadows. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Say it, say it, say it, say it, shout.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Your name is power.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Let's keep singing that a little bit. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Sing it louder than us.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Say what?
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Say it to him.
Hallelujah.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over what? Over every heart and every mind. Oh, cause I know there's peace within your presence. What do you speak? I speak Jesus. Your name is power.
Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Break every stronghold.
Break every stronghold.
Shine through the shadows.
Burn like a fire.
Let's shout it one more time. Shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountain. Jesus in the street. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus,
your name is power.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name. Break every
Let's not stifle the spirit. And speaking of moving in the spirit, it's deposit time. Hallelujah. I see a lot of cheerful givers out there. Amen. Woo. Glory, glory, glory. It's Jesus. I can't think of a better reason to want to make a deposit today than to make a deposit in the kingdom so that we can see what Jesus can do for you and me. Every nickel, penny, dime, dollar that you have in your pocket, he enabled you to make that. Everything that is good comes from him. I was like, wow, you know he's awesome because everything he touched is awesome. And I always think about when he turned that water into wine. And that was like the minister of the ceremonies, he said, the master of ceremonies said, ooh, most people serve the good stuff first and save the expensive stuff for last. So he was saying that Jesus made some expensive wine, the top of the line. Amen. That means that you too can be like expensive wine, the top of the line. All you got to do is just let Jesus touch you and use you. Most honorable Father in heaven, we are humbling ourselves before you, first of all, to say thank you. Thank you for an opportunity to sow a seed into the kingdom. Lord, may every coin, dollar, the transfer, be used to glorify you in the kingdom. May we continue to do the wonderful works that we do here at City Church 242. May we continue to change lives. May we continue to change that stinking thinking so that God can use us and we will learn more about the will of God when our mind is stayed on you. Most honorable Father in heaven, in Jesus' name, amen.
They're awesome, aren't they? All right. Couple of quick announcements before we jump into our topic this morning. If you're a visitor here, we want to welcome you. If you'll fill out the card in the seat in front of you, if you have a prayer request, please put that down. And if you'll turn that in the lobby to Miss Sita, she has a gift for you as our way of saying thank you for spending Sunday with us. And then remember, on Wednesday night, we have Encounter here at 7 o'clock. Friday night, we have Gang. So today, I want to go to Genesis chapter 2 and verse 4 through verse 7. Something happened earlier this week. I was having lunch with somebody, actually Pastor Morrow from Stockton, and he shared a thought with me, and as he shared the thought with me, a light bulb went on, and I realized what he had stumbled on and shared with me, and then it just became what we call Rhema, living word, in this text in Genesis, and I decided today that I want to share it with you. And it's Genesis chapter 2, verse 4 through verse 7. We're looking at creation. And follow this text really carefully as we go through it. It says, "This is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created. When the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, and no shrub of the field had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant of the field had yet sprung up. For the Lord had not sent rain on the earth, and there was no man to work the ground. But the streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground, and the Lord God formed the man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being." What I discovered in this text was something that I had never seen before. Actually had just glossed over it reading this over the years. But let's follow the text again closely. You see that God is creating. He's creating the heavens and the earth. He's creating everything except vegetation. He doesn't create the vegetation because there is nobody to take care of it. He doesn't create the vegetation because he hasn't created man yet to take care of it. Another way of saying it is, he hasn't made something that was in his plan to make. It was in God's plan all along. That is part of creation. But he stopped. He stopped his creative ability because there was nobody to take care of that part of creation. And he stopped saying, "I will let it be non-created until there is somebody that can take care of it." Are you following? That is deep to me. That is so deep. It just kind of blows my mind. Because the ramifications trickle down to you and I. And the way that I looked at it is, when God looks at you, just like he looks at creation, he doesn't make stuff up as he goes along. He had a beginning of your days. Bible says that he knew you before you were born. He knew your whole life. He knows the end date of your life. And within that scope of time, he has plans and design and miracles for you in your life. He has a purpose. He has a design for you. Now, sometimes we get off track. Sometimes we don't help God in that. But He still has a design and a purpose that was before you were born nonetheless. Does that make sense? You may have destroyed it, but God's plan still stays in place. Just like with creation. He had planned a complete creation, but He stopped because man wasn't in place to take care of it. And He wasn't going to create something that could not properly be taken care of by man. So He stopped. Now, that brings up a lot of things to me, because you can go down all kinds of roads with this scripture. Let me just give you, I'm just going to give you a couple this morning, and I hope to recircle around again next week and pick it up from a different angle, because it is so important to me that I get it and that you get it. So the first thing that I wrote this note to myself, that God doesn't give to the unqualified. You see, we think that we pray and that we ask God for all kinds of things. But as I linked it back with creation and His refusing to create plant life until there was an adequate, qualified person to take care of it, Adam, that the same applies to us. That we can pray for all kinds of things, and God is waiting for us to be qualified before He actually gives it to us. It doesn't mean that He doesn't want to. It doesn't mean that it's not in His design to give it to you. It doesn't mean it's not in His purpose for your life. It just means that He has put it on hold until you're qualified. See, your job and my job is to become qualified. And until we're qualified, He isn't going to give it to us. It would be like somebody working in a warehouse as the custodian. And that person has a dream of being the CEO. And they pray, God, help me to be the CEO. I want to be the CEO of this company. But how many of you know that you have to go someplace, you have to learn some things from the maintenance, from the janitorial, to the position of CEO? There's a process of learning that happens to get you there. You have to first learn to run the warehouse. You have to learn how to manage people. Then you have to learn how the front office works. Then you have to learn how finances work, because you have to be able to read the P&Ls and the balance sheet to know if you're making money or losing money. And then just maybe someday you'll be qualified enough to be the CEO. But when we pray, we want God to simply fast track us there and jumpstart us. We want God to just pick us up from the janitorial room and put us in the CEO office sitting behind a big desk. I know that's how I pray. I pray that all my whole life. I don't want to learn how to get there. I just want to be there. You teach me when I'm there, but just put me there. That's how I operate. But I see here in Scripture that there is something, there are times when God says, no, because you are not qualified to be there. It's almost as though God is waiting on you. I have this for you, but now I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for you to come to a place where you're qualified for me to give it to you. We see, we use this a lot when we talk about relationships. There are a lot of people praying for their significant other in a relationship. Oh, God, give me this beautiful, smart, intelligent, understanding, caring woman, God. But sometimes God is saying no, because if he did, you would destroy her. He's waiting for you to be qualified. And in the process, he's working out some issues in your life. Because until those issues are worked out of your life, you have no business being with that fine, intelligent, caring woman, because you'll ruin her for good. And then we wonder why we go through life with daily challenges all the time. See, if you're having a problem right now in a relationship or a friendship with somebody, that they just rub you wrong and they get on your nerves, well, you might take a second and step back and say, could this be God preparing you, qualifying you for that relationship with that fine, smart, intelligent woman? Because if you can't relate here, you'll never relate there. And as long as you keep saying, look at me, God, I'm unqualified here, but give me that there, he's going, no, if you're unqualified here, you're unqualified there. And God cares enough for the other person to not let you destroy her. But see, we get frustrated when we pray because we want God to do it now, my way, and we don't stop and think for a second, could God be sparing her? Could God be sparing you from your own demise? You see, sometimes no has a reason behind it. It's just not no for the sake of no. There's a reason behind it. I want to look real quick at Matthew chapter 25, and we're looking, starting at verse 14. I see this played out in this teaching of Jesus in Matthew. Matthew chapter 25, verse 14 through verse 30. This is a really interesting parable. He said, and it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. Actually, this word, some translations use the word talent. It's actually he's entrusting his money to them. And to one he gave five talents of money, to another two talents, and to another one talent, each according to his ability. Remember this, each according to his ability. That's important. Then he went on his journey. And the man who had received the five talents went at once and put his money to work, and he gained five more. So also the one with the two talents gained two more. But the one who had received the one talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and he hid his master's money. And after a long time, the master of those servants returned, and he went to settle accounts with them. And the man who had received the five talents brought another five. The master said, Master, he said, you entrusted me with five talents. See, I have gained five more. And his master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. Remember that. You have been faithful in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man who had gained two talents also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with two talents. See, I've gained two more. And his master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Then the one who had received the one talent came. Master, he said, I knew you were a hard man, harvesting where you've not sown and gathering where you've not scattered seed. So I was afraid and I went and hid your talent in the ground. So here is what belongs to you. And his master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I had not sown and gathered where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. Now, this parable, there are a number of truths embedded in the parable. First, why didn't he give the servants an equal amount? He gave it according to their ability. One had the ability for five, one had the ability for two, one had the ability for one. You see, it's easier to invest and double the one than it is to invest and double five. To double five requires more work and more ingenuity. So God looked at the one servant and he said, I think you have what it takes for me to entrust you with five talents because I think you have the ability to go and make profit on that. But the guy with the one talent, he said, I don't think you have that ability. You've not displayed that ability. You've not shown me that ability. So I'm going to give you one talent and let's see what you do with it. So the guy with the five talents, he went out and he doubled it and he came back and said, I doubled your money. The one with the two talents, he increased it and God blessed him. But the one with the one talent, it was right for the master not to trust him because he went and hid it in the ground and did nothing with it. So here's my takeaway. In this parable, God says to them, the two that invested and made profit, he said, you were trusted with little, now I will make you over much, right? See, it works this way. If you can't handle $100, then you certainly can't handle $500,000. If you can't handle $10, you certainly can't handle the $100. God will give you what he knows you can handle. Like those servants, Jesus has drawn an illustration of what heaven is like on earth. God will give you what you can handle, but he's not going to give you what you cannot handle. It's interesting, as you look at this, the one servant who got one talent, he did nothing with it. He hid it. He buried it. And he waited for his master to come back so he could give it back to his master. Here's the question that I have. I wonder how many believers never reach their full potential because they do nothing with what God gave them. They remain a one talent because they keep burying it and doing nothing with it. It was the two talent guy that invested all that he had that doubled it, and the five talent guy invested all he had and doubled it. There's a principle here that when you invest what you have and you're faithful with little, God will make you over much. But if you cannot be faithful in the little, God will not give you much. In fact, God will take what you have and give it to the guy who's faithful over a lot. And if you're like me, I have to rewind a little bit and ask myself, am I being faithful over that which God has given me? Am I investing it to produce more? See, a lot of people, they grow content in life and they stop investing. And they just figure, well, this is all there is and this is as good as it gets. And I'll just ride the rest of my life out like this. I'm okay. Well, I don't believe that that is the design of God. I believe that God has designed each of us to continue to grow, continue to expand, continue to dominate, continue to be blessed until you check out of this life. That's why I don't believe in retirement. You may not work secularly and have bowed out at a certain age, but you never bow out of working for the kingdom of God. You don't retire from the kingdom. In fact, because you don't work secularly, I'll just throw this in as a dig. Because you don't work secularly anymore, you probably should double, triple work for the kingdom of God. Because you have more time to invest in the kingdom of God. But retiring to me is a swear word. You don't hear me talking that way. That's a swear word. As long as there's strength in this body and in these vocal cords, I'm keep going. And I'm going to keep growing and keep expanding because I believe that's the purpose of God. I don't want to be like the one talent guy. There's another principle here that I want to share, and that's found in Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 22. And there are other verses that support this. I'm just throwing this one out because it's sweet and simple. A good man leaves an inheritance for his children's children, but a sinner's wealth is stored up for the righteous. Did you catch that? God has purpose to give it to you. But until you're qualified, he'll let somebody else hold on to it. And they'll hold on to it until you get qualified. So that tells me there are wicked people that have my stuff. Look at your neighbor and say, not for long, I'm going to get this today. Give me my stuff back. I mean, that's what the Bible says. The Bible says that God gives to the wicked to give to the righteous. Well, think for a minute. Why doesn't he just give it directly to the righteous? Because they're not ready for it. They're not qualified for it. So he lets people that are wicked hold on to it for them until they're qualified. I've used this illustration before, but I'm going to take another run at it. All of our kids, close yours, Desiree. All of our kids, when they first started to drive, I bought them a hoopty. I didn't care what it looked like. It could be a piece of rusted trash. If it could go down the street and run, it was cheap. That's what I bought them because I knew they'd wreck it. And every one of them wrecked their car, destroyed their car, tore it up. I mean, I'm glad I didn't. Until Desiree came up of age. And then Mom had a car that she was retiring, Deborah, and it was not a new Lexus, but it was in really nice condition, Lexus, and we gave that to Desiree, who proceeded to tear it up immediately. In fact, one day she was going to give me a ride. I wouldn't even get in the car. That's after she moved all the McDonald's wrappers and threw them in the back seat and stuff. I said, why didn't the door handle work? Because my girlfriend tried to kick the door open. Well, what is she kicking the door open? By the time we got rid of that car, it looked like a hoopty with a Lexus symbol on the trunk. Here's my point. I should have put it in the garage until she had a couple of hoopty cars that she ruined and learned to respect the value of an automobile and then gave her the more expensive car. You see, God does the same thing with us. You see, God does the same thing with us. You see, why would God give you that fine three-bedroom home when you can't take care of the apartment you live in? When you walk into the apartment and there's spills on the carpet and holes on the wall and mold growing all over the windows, why? And you say, God, I want to live in a better zip code. Give me that three-bedroom. Why would he do that? Why would God give you the new car when you can't take care of the old car that you got? I'm just saying. Why would God give you the better job when you can't be faithful on the job you have now? You might not like the job. You might not like the guy that's over you. You might not like anything about it. But if God puts you there, the Bible says that whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. And as you do it as unto the Lord, you're saying something to the kingdom of God. You're saying, I'm qualified for better. Because if I can do this as unto the Lord, I can certainly do that as unto the Lord. But so many people, they just don't want to qualify to be better. You see, when I see things like this that are keys in God's word, I jump on them. I jump on them big time. They become focal points in my life. See, I've asked God to do some different things in my life that are a major step up from what I'm doing right now. But I'm not necessarily qualified. So what do I do when I know that I'm not qualified? Is I work at being qualified. My son Seth sent me a book title. He said, Dad, you need to get this book. I said, yeah, I didn't read that book, but I read some other books by the same author. But I went out and ordered the book. And if you go back in my office right now, you will see stacks of books. Most of the time I'm reading four at a time, and I probably got another 15 lined up I'm getting to. There are books on the economy, there are books on health, there are books on the virus, there are books on social media, pros and cons, there are books on fast-tracking through social media. There are books on church growth. There are books on management. There are books on mental condition of our society today. Why am I reading all of that, that wide spectrum? Why am I a crazy reading fool? Because I know what I don't have, and I'm trying to get it. I'm taking the talent I have, and I'm sowing it so I can get more talent so that God can say, get ready for a step up, son, because you've done the work, you're qualified. But I can't sit back and complain and gripe because God hasn't done some things in my life when I know how to get it, but refuse to do the work. So, how do you win at this? Well, to me, it's as simple as this. You look at where you want to be. You see, God will always cast vision in your heart. Here's the key about serving God. When you give your life to Jesus, He gives you vision of where He's bringing you before you get there. He drops vision in your heart so that He lays the groundwork out for you, saying, son, daughter, this is where I'm bringing you in life. And once you know where you're going, you have to sit back and say, what does it take for me to go from here to there? What would help me to qualify to be there? Because I'm not there now because I'm not qualified. So what do I need to be qualified? And once you know what you need to qualify you, what you don't have, you start working at getting it. Well, Pastor, I want to own my own business. Well, that is great. Amen to that. I believe if that's what God has dropped in your heart, that's what you will do one day when you become qualified. But until you become qualified, you'll never do it. And if you don't work at being qualified, one day you'll die and never have accomplished it. So what do you do? Well, Pastor, I don't know. Well, what is it? What kind of business do you want to own? Well, I want to own a donut shop. Have you ever worked in a donut shop? Do you know anything about donuts besides eating them? Well, go down to the Krispy Kreme donut shop and apply to work there. Let's start with learning the business and letting somebody else pay you to learn their business so you can go down the street and compete with them. Do you have a clue how to pay those bills and pay employees and employee tax and withholdings and all of that? Oh, you don't. Well, why don't you go down to the college down there and enroll in some accounting courses? Or if you know somebody in the business, ask if you can volunteer to help them in their business while you learn it so that when you have your business and you have money coming in, you will know what to do to sustain it. Because without that knowledge, God can give you the donut shop, give you the building, give you customers, and you'll go broke within 6 months. You'll file bankruptcy. You'll have creditors coming after you for the next 10 years. Now, why would God do that to you and bring that kind of harm to you? Because He loves you enough not to give you the donut shop until you're qualified. But you have to figure out what it is in your life that keeps you from it. It works that way as a church. I study church growth. I study other churches. I'm not an expert, but man, I study it. I study lighting. I know very little about lighting, but I go out and, man, I start studying. I study sound. Yesterday, I spent the day looking at Joel Osteen's back of the house sound equipment and editing rooms and Ferdix and Bethels. So I came in this morning and told Richard, let's burn our whole sound booth down. It's junk. Let's start over. But I spent hours doing that and researching. And yes, guess what? We're going to start making some changes as a result. We're going to go to controlled lightings. We're going to put in some special lights coming soon. We're going to 3 screens, 3 projectors. We're doing a roaming camera. We're going to do some really trick stuff. Here's the principle. If as a church, you want to go to another level, you have to figure out what don't you have to get you there. And then what do you need to get you there, and lay out a plan of getting it to get there. Does that make sense? It's that way with everything in life. You need to look at your life where you're at right now and say, God, drop in my heart, what are you doing in my life? Where am I going? Where are you taking me? And then once you have that vision in place, sit down and figure out what don't you have that you're going to need to get there. What don't you have? What skill set don't you have? And then go about mastering, learning that skill set, and one day you'll find God put you there. Because he doesn't set you up for failure. He's not setting you up to go out and get into a business and fall flat on your face. I don't believe that's God's will and God's plans. If you do, it means you did something wrong. You got ahead of God. And you set yourself up for failure, but don't blame God for that. Last thing I want to give you, and I hesitate in giving this to you because I don't want you to think for a minute that I'm chasing money. If you notice, we've already taken the deposit, right? Common sense would have been, don't take the deposit until you tell them this. Then you take the deposit, right? But we already took it, so it's done, okay? So I can just be kind of honest with you. The thought of tithing came up. And as I thought about it, tithing is the same principle. Now, hear me out. Tithing is really simple. Tithing, Old Testament tithing, is based on our giving 10% of what we get, right? Okay, so that means if I make $10, I give $1, all right? If I make 10 cents, I give 1 penny. If I make $1,000, I give $100. Here's the interesting thing about tithing, is it doesn't start when you get where you want to go. It starts where you're at right now. Well, you don't understand. I don't have a paycheck. I don't have any money. I only have change. Well, how much change do you have? If you have a dime, give a penny. You see how it works? If you have a dollar, give a dime. Tithing starts wherever you're at. Remember that. Well, when I get a big salary, I'll give God money. No, it starts with where you're at. Listen carefully. The principle is how can you be trusted with little, or how can you be trusted with much if you can't be trusted with little? So, if I have a dollar and I cannot give a dime, how can I be trusted with a couple $1,000s? If I can't be trusted on the level of a dollar, I certainly can't be trusted with a couple $1,000s. Right? See, tithing isn't for God, it's for you and me. We think when we take a deposit or an offering that we're helping God. They're not helping God. In fact, I think that's comical to think that we think we can help God. Last I looked at it, he owns it all. And he can take it whenever he wants it. But somehow we think that we're all that when we give. And people that are big givers, not all, some are very humble. But some big givers feel like if they ever left the church and stopped giving to the church would close. Oh, I got news for you. God's got other big givers out there. He don't need you. So, it's not for God. It's for you. Listen to this Malachi. Now we use this verse a lot. And I try to stay away from it because we use it way too much. But there's something in this verse. There's one word I want you to see. Just one word. So I'm going to read it to you, and then I'm going to show you what that word is. Malachi chapter 3, verse 10 and verse 1. We use this when we take offerings. It's a way of putting a guilt trip on people. The verses before this is, will a man rob God? And you say, where have we robbed you, God? And God said, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. You've robbed me. And then, see, that's the guilt trip right there. And then, so, anyway. See, that's why we already took the offering, okay? Bring the whole tithe into my storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me. See, this is the only time in Scripture God gives you permission to test him, and it's in the relationship with money. Interesting, isn't it? No other time does God say, test me, put me to the test. But it's almost as though God is challenging you and me. Go ahead and test me. Test me, see what happens. If nothing happens, don't ever do it again. But test me. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. I will prevent the pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your field will not cast their fruit, says the Lord. Basically, that was money to them, their crops and their vines and their grapes. He's saying, I will protect and increase what you have. Here's the word I want to show you. It is the word, and I will throw open. I will throw open the floodgates. That word stunned me. It's not that God is saying, well, I'll just move, I'll move the door a little bit. We'll trickle some blessing your way. It's as though there is this mound of blessing pressing against the door. And God is saying, I'm going to throw it open. I'm throwing open the floodgates. And it's going to start pouring your way. Okay. How does this tie in to what we're saying? If you're going to be blessed, you have to show that you are faithful in the small thing. If you're going to be blessed to open a business, it's going to take money to open the business. And in order for you to get money to open the business, somewhere along the line, you need God to bless you financially as well as blessing you in some other areas, but you're going to have to be blessed financially. If you want to go from the apartment to that three-bedroom home, you got to treat the apartment right and show that you're qualified. But at the same time, let's be real, it's going to take some more money, isn't it? Because what you're paying in the apartment is going to be a lot less than what you're paying in the home. So it all comes somewhere. Money factors into it. Somewhere. So what Malachi is saying is God's got a reserve of money for you. But he only gives it when you show that you are faithful, qualified to have it. Because if you can't be faithful in the little bit of money, you'll never be faithful in the lot of money. And if he gave you the lot of money to go open the donut shop, you'd spend it on all kinds of the wrong stuff. You'd be driving in with your new Cadillac and stuff while the donut shop's going broke. Because your priorities are wrong and your character is wrong. What does tithing do? Tithing shows that a man or a woman have their priorities right. God first, me second. And it shows that I have character. So when God sees my priority right with the $1 bill that I give a dime, and he sees my character is right, I'm positioned now to be blessed. And what I need to learn, now that I've got the money part taken care of, you do what you're supposed to when it comes to giving. You do what you're supposed to, and don't worry about the rest. God will bless you financially. He doesn't always tell us how, but he just says, I will. Test me and see if I will not throw open floodgates for you. So now that we've got the money taken care of, now we can focus on what other skill sets do I need to get me to the place that I can open my donut shop. Somebody said, well, have you secured your financing? Oh, yeah, I tithe. It's secured. I give to God. It's secured. Years ago, I mentioned before, and I'm just going to tell you a little snippet. I was working with a company down in San Francisco, and God told me to leave that company, which I did. And through somebody, God spoke to me about going back into developing. I had been in that, and I got out of it. I'd been out of it for quite a while. And so I decided, okay, I'd jump back in. And when some of my partner friends heard that I was going to go back in it, they all said, if you're in, we're in, we're going to follow you, and let's do this thing, right? So I didn't know where to begin, and I just knew that God had set that in my heart, that that's was going to happen. And so my friend, broker friend, we started chasing deals, land deals, nothing worked out, and I found myself down in Central California chasing land deals throughout that corridor, and found this little lot, sleeping lot, in Ceres. And so we secured the lot. We're going to start with a duplex. We have to start someplace, and the duplex seemed like the right thing. Our goal was to do apartment complexes and things like that, but we have to start somewhere. And I couldn't get financing. I went to five banks, and every bank told me no. They would say to me, you've been out of the game too long. You're out of touch with reality. you've never built in this area of California. You don't know the values out here and turnarounds, all of that. And I said, well, and each bank would tell me no and give me a different reason. So I'd go back and do my homework. And I'd learn about what they told me that they thought I didn't know. So I studied escrows and length of times and all of that, values and blah, blah, blah. The fifth bank I'm going to, now I'm desperate. I go to the fifth bank and I'm saying, God, you've got the money there because I'm faithful and I know you've got the finances. So I go to the fifth bank and the manager over construction lending, the vice president over construction lending, we talk, and he says, son, he says, I was younger then. He says, son, I just don't think you have what it takes. I said, I look at your portfolio. You've done only custom homes and stuff. You've never done this stuff. I said, yeah, but I know what I'm doing. And I know what I'm doing. And you need to give me the money to show you that I know what I'm doing. And he said, well, son, I don't know. We don't take gambles like that. He's looking through the portfolio and he sees a home in the country club of Modesto, Del Rio Country Club. He goes, is that your home? You built that? I go, yeah, we built that. So he says, I belong to that country club. He said, so let's go. I'm taking you to lunch and you show me the house. Prove it to me. I forgot where the house was at. I didn't live there. I built one house there, meaning I drove in one way and left the same way. I didn't care about the neighborhood. Never been to the country club. So we go and he makes all the small chit-chat talk about the country club. And I'm sweating bullets. I'm dying 1,000 deaths. This man's going to call me a liar. So we finish lunch. He goes, okay, show me where the house is at. I am praying, saying, God, show me where the house is. I forgot where it's at. So I'm praying, and we're driving, and I feel God say, turn left. So I tell him, turn left. And he'd go left, and I go, man, I don't remember anything about this street. And then we go a block, and I feel God say, turn right. So I'd say, turn right, and he'd turn right. And I'm, God, you better tell me where to turn next. Turn left again. We turn left. And he goes, oh my gosh, that's the house. He looks at that's the house. You did build that, didn't you? I said, I told you I did. So we went back. He signed the deal, gave us the money. We knocked. He said, you won't sell it. I said, yes, we will. We'll sell it before it's finished being framed. And we did. We took in a contract, almost full asking price, before it was done. Finished it up, sold it. And he said, son, I don't know. You do know what you're doing. We'll go wherever you go. We maxed that bank out. He had to turn us on to another lender. We maxed that lender out. And that's what created Better Building Development throughout Central California. How did it start? How did it start? It started with God giving me a dream. God gave me a dream. Doing my homework. Spending weeks looking for the one lot to start. One lot. Weeks. I was all over Northern California just about chasing property. Found the one lot. Went to bank after bank and got turned down. But in my heart, I knew God had a bank that was going to say yes. And if I had to go to 100 of them, I'd find the one that would say yes. Because I believed God was going to give me the money because I was faithful to him in my finances. And I proved that if I could be a great steward over what I had here, I could be a steward over thousands here to build property. And he did. He did. It's the same way with everybody. It's the same way with me now. I believe that if I'm faithful with what God has told me to give, that money source will never run out. And he keeps giving dreams of where you're going next. He keeps giving dreams. I dream every week. I see things every week. And it sets the course for my life going forward. I'm not doing that anymore. I'm very church-centered right now. So most of my dreams right now are about this church. And I'm telling you, this church won't be the same a year from now. Got a dream? I'm learning how to get there. Not just I, we, there's a team of us learning how to get there and believing God to supply the finances to do it. So get ready. Put your seatbelt on. Get ready and rock your world. God's going to do some stupendous stuff. As the worship team comes, we're going to close out with a song. But here's what I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to do three things. One, I want to challenge you that if you don't have a dream, I want you to ask God to drop a dream in your heart of what His plan for your life is. That's one. Two, if you don't know what you need to get there, I want you to make a promise to God that you're going to sit down this next week and with His help, you're going to make an outline of what you lack that you're going to need if you're there. Okay, could be one thing, could be two things, it could be two dozen things, but make a list. If you need help with your list, go to somebody who's already there. And ask them, what skill sets do I need to be here where you're at? And let them tell you. And then third, if you've not been faithful in the dollar and the dime, don't expect God to financially bless you with the money it's going to take to be there. Character and faithfulness has got to start someplace. And it starts the very simple thing of tithing, which starts where you're at right now. Amen? Amen.
There may be pain. live. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails.
No, no, no way.
Your love never fails, Jesus. You make all things work together. You make all things work together for my good. Work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. Joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Your love never fails. You make all together for my good.
You make all things work.
You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good. You make all things work together for my good.
Gentlemen that will be passing out slips of paper like this, and it says ask anything about relationships. So we're inviting you. In a couple of weeks we're going to be celebrating a Valentine's Day, and on that Sunday, not next Sunday but the following Sunday, Deborah and I are going to do something that I don't think we've ever done before. We're going to sit up here and we're going to take your slips, and you can ask anything you want about relationships. You don't have to sign it. You can ask us how many times we fight in a week and who wins. Anything you want. And not that we have the perfect relationship. I'm not trying to hint at that. But what I am saying is that we want to be honest about relations. We've been married for 30 years and 32. You see, don't see? I'm already starting out wrong. You can ask anything you want, and we're just going to have a little fun with it, all right? So if you're not in a relationship, you want to ask questions about how long do you date? How do you know it's the right person? Whatever, anything you want, you ask. That's, grab them at the door, leave them on one of the tables out front when you leave. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for a wonderful, wonderful time that we've had in worship, honoring you, proclaiming the name of Jesus as King above all kings. Lord, we thank you, we bless you.
Now you're sad and blue. There's always someone who has it worse than you. Sometimes you gotta pay your dues. So don't worry, just push on through.
keeping it real. Gotta be the